So I'm very glad to be here. It is a great moment in my scientific life. I've been a mathematician. I work with computational mathematics. The goal has always been to understand physical phenomena by using mathematics. And sometimes I think that maybe that is the only way to understand real physics. Now you have a phenomenon of not understanding mathematics, which is quite common. And that is, you could say, to all the many who have this sort of deficiency, that is okay. It doesn't matter if you don't understand mathematics, because you can get by anyway, if you have a good intuition and so on. What is dangerous is to misunderstand mathematics. It is about understanding the root of a misunderstanding. And if we now listen to Jan Erik's talk, we understand that climate is governed by thermodynamics and not by not by radiation. So with thermodynamics, which is the truth, there is no alarm. But there is an alarm. The alarm comes from CO2 alarmism. It is based on a specific postulate. The idea is that if you double the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, you get 3C warming, and that is alarming. It's called climate sensitivity. This postulate is based on something called the greenhouse effect, that the atmosphere heats the Earth's surface by radiation. It's called back radiation from the atmosphere. So that is the basic postulate that we now will try to come to grips with. And so I got into this, my interest in climate started when I started my blog 10 years ago. And to have something to write about, I picked up climate, and I quickly understood there was something really wrong here. And it was from the background of a proof of Planck's radiation law, a new proof that I had been interested in. And I had fabricated a new proof of the meaning of Planck's law, which is behind the supposed back radiation. But my proof had no back radiation. In my proof, the back radiation was fiction. So there I had something to go on. And it made me then understand that CO2 alarmism is a bubble. And the question is then, how do you make a bubble? If you know that, it's a very, you can make a fortune. Suppose you have a 1% pump, a small pump. Okay, you want to make a bubble. Suppose you have nothing. You have a net here, which is zero. Okay, nothing to start with. You will get nowhere with your pump. But you go to the bank, you borrow 100, get a debt of 100. Suddenly you have an equation. Zero is equal to 100 minus 100. Now you apply your 1% pump on this big number here. Suddenly you have 101. You go back to the bank, and with your little pump, from zero, you have one. You understand that with this pump you can make any fortune. And this is, in fact, used a lot. It is how Swedish economy, state economy, is run. The state bank buys state obligations from the state of this level. It creates a lot of money, and we have a bubble in Sweden. Okay? We know that. But everybody profits from it, so it goes on. Okay, but we have a history of devaluation, so it has a backside, and the sad side is the catastrophe from the bubble. Okay, so the bubble economy truth is that if you have a net, which is small, you write it as the difference of two big things, gross. If you take 1% of the gross, you get something big. If you take 1% of the net, it's still small. So to make the bubble, you have to have this equation of something small as a difference of two big things. And this is the CO2 bubble. The greenhouse effect comes from a bubble Planck law. The bubble Planck law has the nature of a net written as the difference of two things, fourth and back. The back is the back radiation from the atmosphere to the Earth's surface. So there you have it. Am I telling the truth? Well, here it is, the greenhouse effect. Here is the bubble rotation between the atmosphere and Earth's surface. A gigantic circle of back and forth radiation, which is the greenhouse effect. This is in the IPCC documents. Here it is, it goes around. Gigantic. If you go out, you feel it. You are just blasted by this radiation. Now, if we take the essence of these two pictures is that, so we have the sun, okay? We know the importance of the sun. It gives us 160 watts per square meter input to the ground. Then you have this exchange between ground and atmosphere on a level which is twice as big. This is how these diagrams are put up. So you have this rotation which is two times the power of the sun in these diagrams. It's there. It's here. It's in the official. It's here. It goes on and go out. You feel it. You almost rotate around in this. Well, if you look at the net here, the net is 20 because the Earth's surface is a little bit warmer than the atmosphere. So 20 is the net. The net is small. The grass is big. So here you have the difference. This is the bubble Planck law. From this you have two times the sun. Now with this fabricated two extra suns, you can get your initial postulate like this. You want to have the climate sensitivity of 3C. You double CO2, well, you say it's a little change. It's a 1% change. It's a 1% pump to double the CO2, because CO2 is the trace gas. Okay, well, you're 1%, but now you apply it to the two extra suns you have. So you, now you have 2% more sun. But that is a lot, because the sun is powerful. So 2% more sun gives you radiative forcing of this amount. And you can calculate it's about 1C, and with feedback you have 3C. So with two extra suns, your little pump, you get the alarm bubble going. Okay. But if you go to net, which is the truth, the net is 20. You take 1% of net, it's nothing. It's nothing. Okay, so that is the truth. So you can compare this back and forth business, two ways of driving a car. You can drive it slowly with small motions, like this, small net, or you can go like this. And you understand that this is called reckless driving, the latter one, and it doesn't work. So this is dangerous, this back and forth plus minus. Okay, so here it is. This is the bubble blank. And if you go into the mathematical models used in the general circulations models, it's based on Schwarzschild's model of radiative transfer. And it is this one. It goes up and down, and it's plus minus, which is creating a lot of extra. Okay, so the bubble started with Arrhenius. Okay, one of the bubbles. The next one was Bert Bolin, another bubble. Contribution, and then we have our Prime Minister with one of his girlfriends, Shirley MacLaine, in the famous TV program. He wanted to promote nuclear, so we said that fossil is bad. Okay, so that was another. So now we go to the bubble Planck law in more detail. So the Earth has a temperature T2, atmosphere temperature T1, a little bit smaller. Here is the radiative transfer, according to Planck's law, between the Earth's surface and the atmosphere. So this is supposed to go out from the Earth's surface, but this comes back. Net is forth and back. It's two-way. This is an interpretation of Planck's law, which is a misunderstanding of the nature of Planck's law. So it has this form. It's back and forth. Warm heats cold, cold heats warm. Back and forth. with big quantities. It is like this type of argument, where you really have lots of energy going back and forth. It's also unstable as a marriage. Now, the wonderful thing is that if you don't believe that there is any back radiation, you think it's a bubble. No. There is an instrument that proves that there is back radiation. It's called the pure geometer. It looks like this. You can buy it. It has these back and forth arrows you see here down. It comes in, comes out. This pure geometer works like this. It supposes there is the bubble Planck law. The pure geometer records a net of 20, say. A little difference between, you point it to the atmosphere, you get a reading on the pure geometer. The instrument records a little temperature difference between the atmosphere and the Earth, 10 degrees. It records, this is what it measures, a net. Then it claims it goes so much out and concludes that so much will come back. So this instrument is a ghost detector. It is an instrument which measures net, which is small, but reports back, which is big. You can buy it. And people do that, and they point it to the atmosphere and say, hey, look, read. It says back radiation, 2 times the sun, is my instrument. So it is not so easy to argue with these people that have invested in this instrument. Okay, so what is then the real Planck? Okay, then we go to the original source. I find that if there is a dispute in science, go to the original source and see what it says. And usually it says something different than it is said about it. Planck 1900. Here is Planck 1900. It is the beginning at the beginning of the height of the German Empire. Planck takes on the goal to be the scientific leader of not only Germany, but of the whole of Europe. He has a heavy burden on his shoulder. The problem people are speaking about is black body radiation. How much does a body at a certain temperature radiate with respect to other bodies that radiate? Black body radiation. It had to be solved by German science to keep the prestige, to keep the empire from collapse. Planck had this burden on his shoulder. We have the same problem today. We have another problem, the Energiewende, fossil-free society. Again, Germany has taken on the burden to carry humanity through this new world. Okay, so what did Planck think at this moment of his critical moment of his life? Well, this is what he says, which is very interesting to follow before he presented his law, the proof. The whole procedure was an act of despair because theoretical interpretation of black body radiation had to be found at any price, no matter how high that might be. I was ready to sacrifice any of my previous convictions about physics. For this reason, on the very first day when I formulated this law, I began to devote myself to the task of investing it with true physical meaning. So he improved the Planck law, but the meaning, he resorted to statistics to prove his law. He could not prove it with rational argument. So he said, I use statistics. I say that by statistics, somehow you get my law. So he could prove it. But it was not a real proof. It was a proof with statistics which lacked physical meaning. So the meaning of his proof was not understood. So it was open to misunderstanding. And there is the misunderstanding, the root to the misunderstanding of his law, his bubble Planck law. Because it was not a good proof. It did not display actual physics, bubble physics. So in the new proof I had worked on earlier, was to find a deterministic wave equation, classical physics style proof of Planck's law. And so I set up that it's a question of resonance. It is a question of high frequency cutoff, where high temperature can radiate higher frequencies. An exchange of so where sort of the high frequency cutoff of a colder body is smaller than a warmer. And it is the difference that is in the one-way transfer from warm to cold that governs the radiation. And it is very close to the heat transfer by radiation is very close to that by conduction. And that is Fourier's law. Everybody knows that. You have your inside temperature and you have your outside temperature. And you have a flow of heat through the wall, which is proportional to the temperature difference. This is Fourier's law. It goes from hot inside to cold outside, one way, only net. There is no back conduction. The cold outside does not heat the warm inside. Everybody understands that this is so. So it's so obvious. So it is in this setting, if you make a little change here of the conductivity, like changing the atmospheric constituency by 1%, a little change of conductivity means a little change of net. So it's not little. It's you don't get anything big out of it. Oh, the real Planck has the same nature. It's just that the power of the temperatures is different. It's the fourth power instead of the first. It's one way from warm to cold. And in fact, this is what you find in engineering books. Now, where comes the bubble Planck from? Well, so here you have them. Fourier, Planck, one way, like, you know, in a nice family context. The mother tells the daughter something because she knows a little bit better. Now, where is the bubble Planck law? Where does it come from? Well, you say, now you come to mathematics. So here is the real Planck. One way, just from warm to cold. Now you say, algebraically, you can write this. I know mathematics. The parentheses here, I can write it like the difference of two things, algebraically. Wow, suddenly you have your bubble Planck. Here it is. Now you have it as net, fourth, back. The algebraic formality you have turned into a physical reality. Well, this is what you call voodoo science. If you believe that the formality, like putting a stick in a doll, a formality, has the real effect of killing your enemy, this is voodoo science, where the formality is turned into reality. And this is in the misunderstanding of Planck's law that is behind the bubble of CO2. Well, here is when Planck realized what he had done at the later stage of his life. He understood that he did something, he never liked what he did. And here is Merkel, where she understands what she has done. Okay, so the new proof is just that you have a transfer with the spectrum from the higher cutoff to the lower cutoff. 10 minutes left. Okay, good. So it is a deterministic proof, and it has then the quality of, first of all, different bodies, they interact by resonance. So when we, here I am, a body, and it's another amount of bodies, and we radiate, but we do it in resonance. And if I'm a little bit more agitated than you, then there is a transfer of energy from the warmer to the colder. And it is a resonance phenomenon. And it is also of the nature that here is sort of like in a communicating vessel, that it is the surplus on one side of the vessel that becomes an equilibration. So it is not an exchange of what is equal. The equal stays the same. Below cutoff for the cold, this stays the same. Above cutoff for the cold, it gets heated. So that is the nature of understanding that how it is possible that heat only goes from the warm to the cold. It is like in the classroom where you say the teacher knows more than the students. And then you could say when the teacher says something that the class knows, they below the cutoff frequency for the class, it's nothing, no exchange. When the teacher says something which is above the cutoff for the class, something they don't know, it will cause some kind of frustration in the class. They get warmer or more knowledgeable. Anyway, they accept something from the teacher which is his surplus. What they share, they have no reason to exchange. So the real Planck is 1% of net is nothing. So the warming from the bubble is not there. It's based on the fictitious Planck misunderstanding of Planck's law. And in fact, the climate sensitivity, regardless of this argument of understanding of the bubble, there is a sequence here of reports on climate sensitivity that was 3C, alarming. But if you look here, if you go 2000, it was like 3C, but then now here it is down now to 1. So the climate sensitivity, the effect of doubled CO2, is in lots of reports going down. So you can see by 2030 it will be 0. But we are already here with our bubble argument. So in fact, it is easy to pinch a bubble if you find a needle. And then it goes away, pop, and it's as if it never existed at all. And maybe this could be the effect of this meeting, because a bubble is very sensible to attack. Well, anyway, this is the contribution I think I can make to this question. So thank you.